Thanks for inviting me. It's lovely to be back to Oxford. It's a turbulent summer. July was when we were here, isn't it? I'm very happy on the one hand that the Labour Party is having this interactive, participatory way of redefining policy framework. On the other hand, I'm a little bit worried how little different parts of policymaking is being integrated and communicating to each other when we speak of separate policies. So for me, we should start with the priorities for our whole economic and social policy at the Labour Party. What are the key challenges that we want to solve in the 21st century? And industrial policy will serve them. It will be one of the tools in our toolkit that will serve those priorities. So I define our priorities as full employment, equality, and ecological sustainability. In no particular order, I wish to add. And any policy that we are implementing has to be consistent with not just one of these targets, but all of them. And indeed, it's not rocket science. There are no trade-offs necessarily between having decent jobs for all men and women, with a more equal distribution of income, power, and wealth, and ecological sustainability. But we need to be conscious of our policies, that they address all of these, not all of them. And it will necessarily require a massive restructuring in our economy where we stand. But yes, we can make it, and I'm not defeatist. But it is difficult. It requires mobilizing all the tools in our policy kit. Industrial policy is one of them. Public investment policy in social and physical infrastructure, I would say, is a component of industrial policy. And I will try to clarify what we mean by social and physical infrastructure. But of course, we have in our policy kit fiscal policy as well. And yes, we have monetary policy, and we have income policies and labour market policies to make sure that what we do does address issues of inequality and lack of decent jobs. Now, so what did we learn from the dreadful 3 years of policy in this country and elsewhere under neoliberalism? Well, what I learned is to address these challenges, we need high investment. High investment doesn't happen just by talking about giving incentives to firms. So this is where the Tories' white paper is getting it all very wrong. It requires policies that will re-establish the broken link between private profits and private investment as well. And when you want to do that, that brings me to thinking about public investment. I am interested in public investment for other reasons as well that I will revisit later. But if you want a decent private investment performance, you have to start with public investment. The public sector has to lead the way in key sectors, which I will try to define later. Of course, we need to change corporate governance, and the document is asking questions about that. How do we create incentives for long-term private investment, and at the same time, disincentives for short-term speculation? This is, I'm not going to call it financial investment, it is financial speculation. Private companies are sitting on a lot of profits. They're using it to share back their share, to buy back their shares. They're using it for currency speculation. They're using it to buy the shares of other companies here and in distant world. So we have to find ways of reinstating the link between profits and investment. That will require talking about taming financialization of our economy, broadly speaking. Part of it is about regulating finance and narrowing down the area of speculative financial opportunities for private, non-financial corporations. It will also require incentives in terms of bringing them back to focus on their long-term targets, work together with their employees, as opposed to pleasing the very narrow short-term interests of their shareholders by distributing as much dividends as they can in the shortest possible term. So this is, again, thinking of corporate governance. It's not just taming the financial sector, but it's taming the financialization of the non-financial corporations. And of course, also requires decreasing inequality. Now, we are interested in equality as a value, but we should also be interested in equality if we want a stable economy. Obviously, we are interested in equality because we want a stable society, but beyond that, if you want better private investment performance, those firms want a stable market with households with a stable purchasing power. This requires workers that earn a decent living, that can make their short-term and long-term consumption plans based on a healthy wage growth as opposed to a very fragile piling up of debt. So, of course, if we want then a decent industrial policy, this is why you also have to talk about labor market policies. We value quality, but for stability, the Bank of England, if it wants to stabilize its economy, decrease the dependence on debt that drives the growth model of this country, it has to talk about equality as well. Now, I said I want to talk about public investment in more detail, how it serves those three priorities if we value them. Equality, full employment, and ecological sustainability. So our public investment policy should try to hit all these social, ecological, and economic needs. And this is about then focusing on certain things that we think that need to be publicly provided. What are these? For me, infrastructure is at the core of it. Infrastructure where benefits do not just accrue to the individual users, but where they have a public good character and benefits accrue to society as a whole. So when we think about infrastructure, and this is also what is much missing in our talk about industrial policy many times, we often think about transport. Well, infrastructure is also about education. It's also about clean energy. It's also about health and social care. Well, particularly for me, public investment has to think of goods and services where we think access to these goods and services have to be a human right. And if we leave it to the private supply of these goods and services, where necessarily profit motive would be at the heart of the supply of these goods and services, what we end up is an undersupply of these services. If you leave it to the private sector to supply health services, there would not be enough high quality private health service supply. There will be some high quality private health supply at a very high price, which will be affordable only by the privileged few. So this is why if you think access to health is a human right, access to decent housing is a human right, and actually our human rights conventions do say that. Human rights isn't just about the right to have a safe life. It isn't just about the right to freedom of speech. It's also about the right to access to health, housing, and certain public services. If this is the case, and if private sector, private profit motive doesn't secure adequate, decent, high quality, and an adequate amount of supply of these services or goods for that matter, we need to provide them publicly. And public here should be defined obviously broadly. It can be municipal, it can be state. And one most important example of that is of course care. It is healthcare but also social care. Now, the other area where we think public investment is very crucial is where we need a large investment to start up the supply of these goods or services. Now, if you need a large investment just to start up a business, well, that usually creates what we call natural monopolies, because it isn't easy to have that much of resources, so there won't be many firms doing it. And also, if you need such a high setup cost to start a business, if the market is split to many firms, it wouldn't be profitable anyway. So you end up in these cases where a private leading company can easily monopolize that industry, a natural monopoly. Well, we need this high investment. So obviously, if it is in its nature, economically speaking, a natural monopoly, then what we need is, again, public or collective ownership in such industries. For me, railways is the example of that. You need so much infrastructure, you wouldn't probably be running it if you there were many companies. What we do in this country is the most absurd thing. The public sector provides the infrastructure and then hands it over to one monopoly running the train, who has the monopoly power over us, as well as the monopoly power over its workers. And we are all being victims of these, isn't it? So basically, there are principles that we can use about where we really need the public sector. Now, so that brings me to the idea of broadly defining social and physical infrastructure. Now, physical infrastructure, I think, is an area around which there is very broad consensus. And for me, the most urgent physical infrastructure need is in green investments. Green, broadly speaking, is about public transport, renewable energy, and housing. And housing includes both building new zero-energy homes, about which we have the technologies. In Austria, there are new council houses and beautiful council houses where everybody would love to live in. There are zero energy houses now. They don't have a housing bubble. They don't have high rents because city of Vienna, since the turn of the century, social democratic, the red Vienna, has been building council houses, and they are still again doing it. Of course, it includes also installation of our existing housing stock. Now, here I'd love to say a few things about the dilemmas that we're facing. I spoke about restructuring at the beginning. If we want to hit both ecological sustainability and employment and equality, we need to start talking about how do we get out of an economy that is so much based on private transport towards public transport. How do we make our very productive, highly skilled workers, the moment producing those private cars, to producing socially and ecologically useful transport vehicles? So it is not that we want them to lose their skills and lose well-paying jobs, but we want those companies to become socially and ecologically more useful companies. We need to think how also we diversify our energy. So for me, obviously, renewable energy is an essential fit. That's about thinking of wind, tidal energy, solar energy, also biofuels, as much as we can think about, of course, the other ecological and the food sustainability dimensions of that. It surely isn't about carbon capture. My heart sinks when I read carbon capture as one of the options that the Labour Party wants to look at when Clive Lewis was launching his industrial policy strategy a couple of months ago. I want to engage in the discussion with my friends in the trade union movement. We do want good jobs, we do want well-paying jobs with clearly defined career paths. We want to protect the rights, existing rights of our organized labor force, but we don't need carbon capture for that. We don't need fracking. Obviously something that will ruin our communities. We need to engage with the massive resistance against fracking up and down in the country, picking different interests from the conservative as well as labor and green constituencies. We have to be the leaders of these movements, so they're thinking that, oh, fracking creates jobs. Fracking creates bad jobs, distances our movement, trade union movement, labor movement from the communities. And yes, we can create enough and good jobs, which produces decent things for the future of our planet and our children. And surely I have to also say that, and I know there's a by-election coming, and it is very difficult to engage in these discussions if you don't build the movement for a long time. Overnight, if in a constituency where people's jobs are depending on nuclear power, I know it is very difficult to talk about nuclear energy, but we should have been doing it long ago, such that now we can convince these people that nuclear energy isn't safe energy. German Chancellor Angela Merkel, by no means a green person, has felt enough pressure on her from by no means the very progressive Social Democratic Party of Germany, sadly, certainly nowhere close to our Labour Party at the time, but also pressure from the Green Party. She accepted that she has to respect this constitutional decision of Germany that they will not go the nuclear route. We just had the catastrophe in Japan. How quickly we forget about these things? Nuclear energy isn't renewable, but it is risky. And we do not need it. We are blessed in this country with the wind and tidal potential, and there are technologies for it. Now, I'm not a technology person, and I'm not the one to, in detail, really speak about ecological investments. And Kilminster, well, your local Oxford economist, if you like, would know more about these things than me, but I'm enough of a layperson like yourself to understand technology is there, and it is not rocket science, or maybe it was rocket science. Economics isn't rocket science. Maybe ecological, the technology, engineering of these ecological production technologies, green energy technologies are rocket science. People have produced these technologies, we need to implement them. Okay, so we need to, our investment strategy, industrial strategy is to address the ecological deficit. I wanted to talk about something that I had talked when I was here in July as well, which is not kind of the usual thing you hear when people talk about industrial policy. This is the social infrastructure dimension of it. This is where I started by saying, where do we need public investment? In areas where it has a social public good character, or service character, where it's a human right and private sector won't do it. Nowhere has done it. So for me, social infrastructure is what we define, purple investment, just to create another buzzword that chimes with green investment. I know it has been, capturing a lot of attention. It's a very good label. Purple investment takes the color from the feminist movement, obviously. And it's purple because it is something the feminist movement has been talking about for a long time. It is investment in childcare, in social care, in also education and health. When you talk about the industrial policy in our circles or in the white paper of the Tories, it is usual to talk about education. Yes, we need skills, we need apprenticeships. Nobody talks about childcare when they talk about education. Surely very few people talk about a healthy labor force, we need an NHS too. And apart from a bunch of feminists, nobody talks about social care for the elderly and the disabled. Now, we have a care deficit in our country too. Thinking of child care as something part of an industrial policy transfers people very quickly because, well, we need a productive workforce for this. Okay, early childhood education is very important. It starts at the nursery. Okay, then it takes a box. When we start talking about healthy workforce, yes, of course, if you're healthy, you will be more productive. People also grasp that easily. When we start talking about social care as part of social infrastructure, not just for a social good, but also for a productive future, people get a bit puzzled. Social care for the elderly, well, these people are at the end of their productive lifespan, so surely it isn't something for productivity. People start wondering. But actually it is. spending, investing in social care also will have both direct and indirect impact on productivity. Well, for one thing, care has to happen. When we don't provide it, somebody else takes care of it. Well, in the room, there are people who's very aware of it because they're joining it. You become the care of some elderly person in your family, and it's usually the women who do it. They do it without being paid, they're invisible. So how do we socialize this invisible labor of women, underpaid, unpaid labor of women, by providing that socially? What happens to these women when they don't have to care for the elderly, but they go and participate in the labor force and they produce something? I'm not saying that what they do unpaid at home, caring people, is not productive. All I'm saying is probably collectively we can provide better care for our older people as well. I would love to be cared by different people that makes me social in my old age. And of course, I'm very worried about my old age, given that there is all the cuts going into our social care provision. And much more indirectly, I think we would be all a lot more productive, innovative, if we are not worried about the care of our mother, father, disabled relative, when there is a decent supply of that. Now, I have talked a lot about this because it's so much under discussed. And obviously, if we want social care to be a decent, worthy of the name, social care, we need to improve the pay and working conditions of the people providing that care. They have to be valued, they're the most important people. I'm sorry, I said it in July, I will repeat, but why are these people being paid so much less than a financial investment banker with one new, you know, deposit your money, with the other you give your mother, father, I suppose we all value these people more than our money, so why don't we value the work they do? Okay, one last word about this social purple investment. It is at the same time also green. Why is it green? At some point we will have to think about the fact that we may not be able to grow exponentially forever given the very limited space of this planet. We should start talking about it today, really. Now, if you want to still have full employment, but if it has to come with lower growth and lower carbon emissions, one way of doing it is surely thinking of more labor-intensive jobs, so that creates a lot more jobs per growth. Well, education, health, social care, childcare are very labor-intensive. And of course, we need to talk about creating more jobs with shorter hours, such that we can manage with lower growth. And obviously, we need to end this inequality. Everyone, I suppose, would be very happy to work fewer hours if they still can rely on the income they're making on that work with shorter hours. Surely, without redistribution from the top to the bottom to the ones in the bottom 50%, we are not going to convince people to work shorter hours. We need to think of how we can increase the hourly pay rate, really, and it means talking about squeezing some of the profits. Now, and of course, any industrial policy has to think about how do we finance it. We need to be realistic. And again, we need to think about all the tools in our policy kit. Well, we need to tax, surely, both income and wealth to finance it. Labour Party is good in saying this. Well, there are at least three other things. One is to borrow. Labour Party is good in now saying it. We will borrow to spend in investment. But it falls short of saying what investment means. Joe McDonald, whom I really appreciate a lot, defines investment as something that is a physical, machinery, and equipment. They're very worried about, I understand, the conservative attack to the Labour Party, that Labour will come and spend again. So that's why the Labour Party has developed this fiscal policy, fiscal credibility rule. But we need to redefine it. Can we not define investment spending in social infrastructure as public investment as well? Can we not define spending in NHS, in childcare, and social care as infrastructure?
And then, of course, we can defend why we are borrowing, because we are investing in our future. Look, I'm not interested in spending more in irresponsible things. I'm interested in spending in areas that we need. Let's define the needs and then let's think how we need it. Surely taxation is one of it. Borrowing is another toolkit. Surely the other policy tool of the Labour Party now, flagship policy, National Investment Bank, is a third source to provide finance for public investment, infrastructure.
I'm going to lose through here.
But the fourth policy about financing our industrial policy, monetary policy, we are completely forgetting to talk about it. It's a taboo. It's a taboo, of course, in all the neoliberal economic policy circles from Europe, European Central Bank to Bank of England. But why can't we use Bank of England's quantitative easing monetary policy to buy government bonds to finance public investment? Why can't we tell Bank of England to buy bonds from this new National Investment Bank, who will then use these bonds as equity to generate more credit to finance some of our prioritized private and public and third sector investment policies? This surely is not leaving everything to Bank of England, hence we need to discuss independence of Bank of England. I know it's also a taboo, but we are limiting ourselves by just accepting these myths. Now, I'll just end by saying, we did crunch numbers, increasing public spending, public investment, by just 1% of our gross domestic product. This is about in spending £20 billion a year in Britain in the current numbers. If you mix that with a progressive taxation policy, increasing taxes on capital, decreasing taxes on labor income, and if you also do the right kind of labor market policies, give more power to trade unions collectively to bargain for better wages, close gender wage gaps, increase the coverage of collective bargaining through all the policies Jane has been talking about. If you manage to, with these policies, increase the share of labor income by 1% of our GDP, that is the wage share, well, we get actually, at the end, so much more income in our economy, with which we also raise more tax revenues. Our budget balance isn't deteriorating, but improving. So we are spending more, but we are also generating more tax revenues. And not just because we are taxing the rich more, but it's also because we are creating a more equal economy that is also then generating even more private investment. You could ask me, oh, does that not show you private investment? Actually, no. This is about building the link between private profits and private investment. Private investment doesn't just look at private profitability, but also sales prospects. If you have a more equal economy, private investment is actually encouraged by that. If you have a better infrastructure, both social and physical, private investment is encouraged by that. Now, I'll end by saying, so what we need really is to think of an equitable and sustainable development strategy that would need green as well as purple public investment and a pay rise for both men and women and shorter hours. So if you take care of then our ultimate aims of policy, which was full employment, equality, ecological sustainability, don't worry about the budget, it's really taking care of itself.